Hello, ladies and gentlemen of the internet, it's Needle here, and welcome back to Lothric at long last. It has been so long. Some things have changed since the last time we recorded a little episode, and I thought we'd take a little second to catch up on those. The first thing is, as you can see, this is not the same character. The reason for that was, I recorded a few episodes after the first one, heading into the first areas of the game, and for some reason, the game did not record properly. It was all messed up and just would not edit right. If you guys saw my How to Kill the Last Giant as a Mage in Dark Souls 2, you'd be, it was all zoomed in and out of kind of proportion and stuff. That was what was happening no matter what I did. So it was right in the middle of my sort of exam time, so I thought, I don't have time to sit and do this and worry about that. I'll worry about it at a later date, and that's what I've decided to do. So this here is my first recording since then. I've done some test recordings earlier in the day, and hopefully from now on it's going to be okay and plain sailing. Second thing is, well, I think it's just time to continue in our journey. I don't really know where I kind of left it at the end of the first episode. I think we just kind of explored Firelink Shrine. I remember we jumped up into the glitch area. I did go to the liberty of doing that again. So we do have the Covet of Silver Serpent Ring here. I am the Knight, and the reason I changed up to the Knight was because I didn't really want to run a warrior anyway. On these runs, when I bring it out on my channel, I like to try and get through as easy and as casual as possible, if you want to put it that way. And I feel like the Knight is just the overall most solid starting class and makes it the easiest time for you guys. So I think also we have an extra Estus Flash Shard, which we've got to 5. Okay, so we're up at 5, that's fine. We explored around there. We did defeat the Swordmaster, I believe. We should have the Ichikatana here. I definitely have on this character. I hope I did that in the last episode on this. If I didn't, then it's pretty simple. You just kind of keep dodging and slashing away at him. If you guys really want another look at that, and I didn't cover it in the last episode, we'll go over that and look at it again. But I don't see any other reason to hang around here for the time being. It's time to head up the first area of the game. It is the High Wall of Lothric. Excuse me if I'm a little bit rusty in this area. I'm just off playing my personal account. I actually just defeated one of the Lords of Cinder on my personal account. I've not actually finished the game yet on my own playthrough, but I'm about 3/4 of the way through now. So I feel like I know this game reasonably well. Not as well as I know Dark Souls 2, as you guys could probably imagine. First things first, as soon as we drop in here, this looks exactly like a Lord Vessel, and it has a bonfire sword poking right out of it. Symbolism, I'm sure. But we spawn in this room, there's nothing really special about it. Perhaps the crest of Dragon Lake there in the face of the king on those gargoyles. Yeah. So we're going to push on out these doors. I think they took away the mechanic from Dark Souls 2 where you're half opening a door, you can just hit to dodge right through it and pushes through. Life required ahead. I am playing online, although it did come back and bit me earlier once I beat one of the bosses about midway through the game on my own file. I carried on into the next area where I was invaded by about 3 people at once, and being rusty at the game, not knowing really how to do PvP in general, I got my ass handed to me. So here's the first bonfire of the area, the High Wall, and we'll take in the surroundings. This obviously is Lothric, as you can tell. It's very Yharnam-esque in its architecture. I really love that about it. Something very similar, but very different at the same time. Second thing you're probably going to notice is that people seem to be turning into trees. Very strange. I'm sure we'll get some more information on that at a later date, but for now, all we can see is that a lot of these people seem to be praying, worshipping. For the most part, they seem to be looking in the one direction, and it appears to be over there towards where I guess the main castle is. Perhaps they're praying to their lord to save them from being turned into trees. Before you make any move down this area, yeah, make sure you drop off here and kill him, because if you go down the stairs, you're just going to get shot in the back by him quite a bit. Dogs in this game are a huge pain in the ass, as you can imagine. Let's see, we're surrounded here, there's tons of enemies down there, and to be honest, there's absolutely nothing down here. There's a semi-tough enemy just up there. Here comes a dog. Missed time with slashes there. I have just been R1 spamming the hell out of the game, so I will take a few episodes possibly to get back into my kind of rhythm. Yeah, there's an enemy up there similar to, not in strength to Gundyr, but similar in that he erupts into one of those big black sort of pus things. And if you destroy them in that form, not before they transform, but once they transform, you are given a Titanite sword, so it could be worth it. I'm just going to hack our way through these dudes. Ow. Again, mistiming my slashes, I'm just spamming the R1 button. I need to be more conservative in the way I play. See this here, when this guy starts ringing this, yeah, you're putting yourself in for a bit of trouble. Luckily these guys all go down in one hit, at least you are if you start with the Knight class. I'll actually show you my stats in a minute, because via killing Gundyr, and the Swordmaster, you do get enough souls to level up a couple of times. So I'll show you where I've distributed my stats right now. 15 Vigor, 15 Vitality, 14 Strength, 13 Dex. Round about that, you start with 12 Dex I think on a Knight, and in order to use the weapon we kind of want to, you're going to need to go 13 Dex I think. Is this guy still alive? He is, that's just making that noise. Raw Gem, that's pretty good early on. Raw weapons are great early game whenever they don't really require any stat investment, and in fact that's another path we're going to not maybe go down, but at least kind of infuse one of the weapons with to show you the effect of it. This evidently is a dragon. Something that's kind of recurring in this area of the game is the fact that these dragons here, they're all over the place. They seem very entwined with the kingdom of Lothric, but they all seem to be dying and definitely fading me into what seems like ash. Rather than head down the stairs, heading down the stairs is where you want to go. We're going to do the typical Dark Souls route of going somewhere else first. Coming up here. Again, there's another guy with here, one of these lanterns. I want to kill him before he gets a chance to ring it. A good tip for you is any enemy that seems to have embers or glowing or anything like that is typically going to be a lot tougher than ones who do not, like these guys. These guys tend to go down in one hit. As you can see, there's these guys. Are a lot tougher. As far as I'm aware, this dragon is fully dead, so you can just hack away and not worry about it. There's no life gems in this game, as opposed to Dark Souls 2, so that's why I'm conserving my Estus and not really just using it straight away. Oh. Thanks for the thrust attack there on the broadsword, or the longsword, I should say. It's a longsword, isn't it? A longsword, yeah. Gets you out of some sticky situations early on enemy, because a lot of kind of thin corridors and hallways. Over there is where we're headed, to that big pointy tower. Over here is nothing. This is what we're looking for, the binoculars! I haven't actually made any kind of use of the binoculars at all in this game yet. But that's okay. It's always good to have, to look at stuff in the distance. If you're running magic, I assume, like most Souls games, when you run magic you want to have the binoculars there to kind of aim at targets from a distance. Although I have heard magic in this game is very, very poor no matter what you do. So we're going to get, maybe not the jump on the enemies, but we're going to get something good anyway. Rather than going down the stairs, you come up here, you drop down on this ledge here, don't worry, it's safe. The one there. You come in here and this is some resin. Yeah. Now if you guys watched the demo or the sort of network test but not the actual kind of how the game works, you might be confused as to how resins and things work, because in the network test we had resins of a sort, but they only lasted seemingly like something like 10 seconds, and there's a reason for that. Hello, very interesting area. We're going to be going out there in just a minute. Not really getting to explore it though. Firebombs! Firebombs are very useful in this area, and factually firebombs and fire in general are very useful in this game. The game is very focused on sort of darkness and ash, and fire plays a big role in it, and a lot of enemies are actually weak to fire, so pay attention to that throughout the game. So a deserted corpse. Now, we don't want to stray too far out here. Keep your eyes on the sky as you come out. Kick this guy. Just ram him with your sword. Smash this guy up, and you only really want to go about halfway. Yeah? No? Okay. Maybe not. Maybe they've changed it. We're going to try and run upstairs, because this should definitely trigger it. Yep, there we go. There's a big dragon. I was hoping it would do a bit more damage. Got ourselves kind of trapped in here, but that's okay. We got ourselves out of that situation. Now. If you run down here, the dragon will kick off again. Just shot the back, please. He'll kill all those dudes down there. You're not really meant to run into a guy this powerful. because the dragon was meant to kill him, but oh, he's still around. Now, we're going to be full HP for this section, because rather than run the easy way down there, which is where we're meant to go, we're going to take the hard way because of what it's going to reward us with, but unfortunately it's going to mean we're going to get set on fire a little bit by the dragon. If you run up onto this wooden platform, by the way, you won't get hit by the fire. You've got to keep going, just fight through it. And then you get to this door. Yay! Yeah, if you stand on that wooden platform, you won't get hit by the dragon's fire. And more importantly, if you have a bow and arrow with about full arrows and you're hitting them in the head and stuff, then you can kill the dragon, well not kill it, but critical injure it to the point that it flies away, in which you'll be rewarded with a large titanite shard, which can be very useful early on in the game, of course. I don't think we have any undead hunter's charms, or Lloyd's talismans, as I guess the game would normally call them. So we're going to put our resin on, power up, and go crazy on this non-chest. No, no, that's what I was trying to dodge. No. Can we escape it or will we die? We've somehow survived it. Ow. I'm gonna kill him. That was touch and go for a little while there. And we're gonna get the deep battle axe as a reward. I highly recommend, if you guys are looking for an easy start to the game, to come and get this thing. 12 and 8. I thought you needed 13 dex for it, but evidently you don't. This thing will rip through a lot of early game enemies, and particularly the first boss of the game as well, so that's why we grabbed it. Dragon's still going crazy out here. Now be careful, because there is actually a particularly tough enemy out here. I used up all my Estus on the way in here. So yeah, you see him in the distance there. Now these guys are Lothric Knights, and they're meant to be on kind of par with the enemies you fight in the Burg and DS and Dark Souls 1 and stuff like that. But these guys are really tough and pretty dangerous, so if you can avoid them, which I thought we could do, but we're not gonna. You see, they have so much stamina and they have moves like this and they're so aggressive. I don't know, they don't feel like early game enemies, and I actually feel quite annoyed by From for putting an enemy like this strong so early in the game. But yeah, especially when you're surrounded by other enemies, because this totally all makes sense. So what you can do is just run by them into this room and up these stairs. And here's the first bonfire, which is totally not letting us activate. Now it should. Can we sit down quickly? Yeah, okay. There we go. So here's the tower on the wall. If you try and snipe the dragon from this kind of area, you will actually just turn round like that and just hit you right in the face. So I highly recommend not doing that, because you won't be safe from his fire. Come back here, get a titanite shard, you can't go up there. Unfortunately. And if we make our way back down here, we can actually sneak by the knight. There he is. What we can do is come over here, grab these fire bombs, and just land softly down. Kind of freed that guy from his hell. Just frozen in place. Raw gem again. Nice. Now that's the way forward. If you drop down again, oh yeah, we do need to go down again actually, because there is something interesting down here. So this is a little bit of a tougher enemy, this dude. He's got big range, like Gundyr had, or Gundyr. I'm gonna call him Gundyr, okay, I've decided. But you can just get behind him and backstab him. This will be locked for the foreseeable future, but it's not too difficult to unlock. if you like to invade, then that's going to be a pretty important door for you to unlock later in the game. Now this here is an old Demon Souls kind of throwback slash trick. In Demon Souls there was a room that which you entered was full of flammable barrels, and the enemy on the other side of the room of course tossed a firebomb and sort of blew you up. So we're going to get the drop on this guy if I can learn how to throw firebombs. There we go. And then we're just going to hack him up. Nothing too interesting in here, I don't think. Throwing knives. There's a guy just to the left in here, so don't let your guard down. Make your way through. Cut him up. This is the Mail Breaker, so we're not going to be able to use it. It's a dex weapon. We're not going dex. We could use it later in the run, but by then we'll have something much better, I think. Small sword. Blah, blah, blah. You guys know how the Mail Breaker works by now. So, if we make our way down, I'm not too sure if there's anything to loot around here. Nope. But if you come in here, you'll find a locked door and a peculiar looking fellow behind it. We're going to come back later. Hopefully not too much later. And we're going to free that man there from his prison, and he's going to become very helpful to us throughout the playthrough. He's going to be our first friendly face back in Firelink Shrine, hopefully. But first, we've got to head this way. I do definitely feel like the early game areas of this game are a little bit harder than all the other Souls games. As soon as you come up here, by the way, you'll be distracted by those two on your left, but this guy will come ahead straight from the front. And he's the guy you want to focus on. If you've got the deep battle axe, two hits you ought to do it. These guys go down in about one, and then this guy's going to try and sneak up on you from over here. This bit can go one of two ways. The guy in the middle, sort of moving up and down right next to the trees, he is going to explode into one of those Puss of Man things. We don't want to deal with that at all. So I'm going to try and kill him before he explodes. If he doesn't, we're going to run away. Oh, okay, we messed it up. Ow. You see, at least they kind of help you out by killing stuff for you. That's always nice. We're going to run. I was hoping he would follow us. Okay, we're going to try and take him out then, I guess. From a safe distance. Firebombs kind of, as you can see, sort of freeze him in place. And you do that. Get your Titanite Shard. Now, lore-wise, I have no idea what the hell those things are. In fact, I've checked some of the kind of forums and stuff, and as far as I'm aware, beyond their name being the Puss of Man, and that they have possibly some relation to the Abyss, nobody knows what the hell they are. I advise that you come down this way. As you can hear the twinkling noise, and that's this dude. I'm gonna try and catch him. There we go. Raw gem again, so we're getting plenty of raw gems here. Large soul. Down there is a nice little area, and this big fat dude. If you play your cards right, you can get him to stand on that fire and pretty much suicide. So, I don't know if we'll be able to do it. It definitely seemed like a glitch when I made it happen. A couple of items down here in the rooftops as well. Now, this is another interesting area that goes one of two ways. You can see there's an enemy there. However, there's also a door underneath us. So, we can kind of pick and choose where we want to go. I'm going to go the way where we can see the enemy. I'm not going to actually going to go that way, but I'm going to run over here because he's going to shoot us. And then we're going to kill him. And then we've got another guy at the end of the hallway, and he's going to get some friends. I'm going to kill all of them. And I believe there's one more. Nope. There's one more down there, but he doesn't seem to have aggroed, which is fine by me. Then we're going to drink this up. And now we're going to go through this room and be confronted with yet another big scary knight. Well, this one has a spear and a shield. There's another way up there. There's lots to see here in Lothric. It's a busy place. So we want this dude to kind of come at us here. I'm going to try and backstab him. I'm still getting my bearings on these guys. I don't really fight them all that often. I've only really come through Lothric Castle the one time. If there's one good thing the battle axe is good for, it's definitely... Oh, Lothric and Great Shield, that's pretty cool. It's for staggering big enemies like that. You see also, I've got that kind of orange glow around about me. Sometimes when you beat difficult enemies like this guy, or in specifics, enemies with the red eyes, mostly, you'll get a free Estus back. So you see I was at 4 Estus and now I'm at 5, well that's why. Right, so this dude's here, but we've also got this dude right here. So gotta play it smart. Kill these dudes. Yeah, there's another trap right here. And we're gonna get another Titanite shard, yeah? So that's another area safely dealt with. Here you're gonna want to equip your firebombs again. Do that. Undead Hunter Charm. So, if you didn't get the Mimic the first time, now you can go back and use the Undead Hunter Charm to get it pretty safely by knocking the Mimic out. Ah, I am over here, we totally didn't even see. Soul of a Deserted Corpse. We actually have quite a lot of souls, so we kind of want to go home right now, but I'm going to wait until we get the shortcut, which shouldn't be too far away. You see there's a pathway down here, and that's the pathway we're going to take down. But first of all, I'm going to want to clear this bit out. Come in here. This is the broadsword. Broadsword is a good weapon. If you don't get the deep battle axe or you don't want to make it too easy on yourself, I suggest getting the broadsword and just switching up from the longsword towards that. As you can see, that enemies downstairs are many and many, many lethal. Very lethal. I'm going to drop down here. This chest is safe, don't worry about it. And here we have the Astora straight sword. Now this, particularly for speedrunners, is a good weapon to run and grab. And then go back to Firelink Shrine and infuse it with raw. So if that's something you guys want to do. I think you do need to build faith for it, that's the only requirement. You do need 12 faith for it, yeah. I only have 9 faith, but you can push your faith up to 12 and then make it a raw infusion and it'll actually last you a fair distance through the game. This is where things get a little bit difficult. There's enemies all over this place, some sleeping, some not so. That right there is an important item which you want to get. There's an important item right down there, which you can maybe just see through the floor cracks. So we don't want to skip out on anything here, we want to make sure we do it right. How are we going to do that? We want this guy dead as soon as possible. It's kind of difficult to do when he's hiding out down there. Okay, he's directly underneath us, we might get away with this. Nope, we got his dog. Maybe from here? No. As you can imagine, from this point it becomes kind of difficult not to kind of mess up. We can try dropping down, grabbing the item, sprinting back up the stairs and drawing a couple of them up there with us. The thing is, these guys do so much damage, that's the problem. I want to hit this thing right underneath us. Nope. There we go. Don't know if we killed him, we didn't. But we didn't have to kill him there, it's okay. These guys are keeping a close eye on us now, they know where we are. That was unintended, but we're here now, oh dear. So we got away with that somehow. A bunch of the enemies somehow killed themselves, oh well, yep. Now we're going to run up here and heal. Guy's down, which is good. He's also still down there. Got a battle axe dude and a pretty standard looking dude. I think we can take them. Just do this. I don't know how he's still alive. Not anymore. you can sneak down into this area, of course. That was an accident. Oh, come on. Then I recommend doing so, because you can take those guys out who just firebombed me. Like the Silver Eagle Kite Shield. We're going to talk about that in a minute, because it is kind of important to distinguish between all the different types of shields in the game. Coming down here, having a look. An item through here. Okay, Night Shard. Most useless of all the items in this room, believe it or not. This. An Estus Shard. You guys have played Dark Souls 2, you know how important Estus Shards can be. Wow, okay. Nice work from the dog there, who kind of jumped through that wall and went, killed them up the stairs and fell through that wall. Important. And the cell key. So, as you can imagine, the cell key is to free our friend locked behind the door. Nothing to see here. This, I believe, brings us out right next to our big scary friend. You can drop off down there. However, there's enemies right underneath you that are sleeping. And you don't really want to draw the attention of that guy either. So we're going to run. Get the hell out of here. I haven't even timed this episode, so I apologise if it does run over long, but I feel like if this is our first episode coming back in the series after so much time, we might as well do it right. And if it takes a little bit longer, that's just what happens. And I wouldn't say a new addition, but a properly implemented addition to this version of the game is you can really be kind of stealthy if you want to be. Mages, unfortunately, because the attack and magic in the game is not really all that great, many attacking mages seem to focus more on sneaking by enemies for the most part. And it starts with this guy. This guy is big and scary, but his range of sort of detecting you is not fantastic. So if you just make your way over here, you can just kind of get out of his way. And you want to run up here. There's going to be a guy probably spawning behind us. That's okay, there he is. We're going to take him out. And this takes us up above Scary Fat Man. This is a large soul, hello friend. But more importantly, this is going to take us up here. Now, you might be tempted to slow down and check out your surroundings here. At this point, I just wouldn't recommend it. Let's just run and go upstairs. Bye bye now. Now, where does this bring us out, I wonder? Grab some throwing knives. Because we didn't clear out the right hand side at the beginning bonfire, this is going to be a little bit more difficult than it has to be. Hello. I think one thing you'll definitely notice if you've come from the other Souls games, and particularly Bloodborne, is that stamina consumption seems very different in this game. The game seems a lot more focused on being able to dodge and things like that, having those kind of options available to you. You see how things can go quickly wrong in this area. Of course, we sat at the bonfire earlier, so that's made a bit of a nightmare for us. I'm going to try and ignore this guy and just run back to the bonfire. And then we're going to use the bonfire to go back to Firelink Train. Yay! We only have really one or two things to do in the high wall before we can move on. You see where we were at the end there. If you played a network test, you know what's coming next. There's a big sort of cathedral area, and at both ends there's something to do, and that's going to complete the first area for us. I'm wondering whether or not to do that or just start the next episode off right now with that probably. Oh wow, look at that slowdown. Sometimes it's great, sometimes things like that happen. So, home, speak to our friendly firekeeper. Well, and we are going to push How many levels are we getting? 3. I think perhaps endurance would be fun right now. We don't really need any more damage at the moment. We're doing okay as far as damage is concerned. Okay. Yeah. Okay, I'm going to do one last thing before I end it. I'm going to leave the actual boss fight and moving on to the next area to the next episode, but one thing we do want to do, of course, is free our trapped friend. And I'll show you the sort of, I don't want to say consequences, I don't think that's a really fair word to use for this guy, but the results of freeing him from his cage, I think, is a more appropriate way of saying that. Well, let this guy sneak out. Okay. I'm going to hop down. The enemies definitely in this game are a lot more intense on your stamina bar. There's a lot of sort of aggressive enemies. I definitely went the Bloodborne route of fast, aggressive, in-your-face enemies. And sometimes it gets pretty interesting and results in some pretty interesting fights. And other times it just makes you pretty frustrated. We'll get to that later in the playthrough, believe me. So that's the hard part done there. Yep, that's how I'm showing this time that. Not that it matters, of course. Out of stamina. Goodbye, sir. And then we're gonna hop on down here to open the cage. Before we speak to this man, we'll see if anything says about the cell key in our equipment. Holding thieves and the like, there's no shortage of brash thieves in Lothric, and this particular thieves likely skilled the wall from the undead settlement. But they are only willing to practice their thievery on the high wall, for their fear of Lothric Castle rumored to devour men keeps them clear of its grounds. Very telling description, of course. All you need to know is this man is a thief. He's come from the undead settlement, which we haven't really heard much about yet. But also they're afraid of the castle because it's rumoured whoever enters that castle will never ever come out again. All important, but all in time. All in time. Let's speak to this man first.
Ah. You're no jailer, are you? No, you're from far away. And judging by the bell, you must be some of that unkindled ash. Remarkable. If that's true, then I have a favor to ask. Below the high wall is a musty little town, not the home of any lord, just a very old settlement of undead. An old woman, Loretta, lives there. Please, give her this ring. I'm not asking for charity. In fact, if you do this for me, I'll be sure to repay you in kind. I may be a petty thief, but I've more wits than most royalty. What do you say then, huh?
So we're going to grant his request, because he seems like a very likeable chap.
Very well. I humbly place my faith in you. I am Grey Rat of the Undead Settlement, and I promise to assist you. Give this ring to old Loretta at the base of the high wall. Do your part, and I'll do mine.
So, a couple of things there then. He has a friend called Loretta in the Undead Settlement, which is somewhere we're going to be well acquainted with very shortly. We have a ring to give her, the blue Tearstone ring. We're going to equip it right now. There's not really much point. I don't find that the Tearstone rings do much in this game. But we're going to put it on anyway, because it's free damage absorption when your HP is low, as little as it may be. His name is Grey Rat, and he says to repay us in kind. But another interesting thing I definitely like about it is that NPCs this time just kind of fade out whenever you're finished talking to them. And there seems to be a sort of reason for that if we use a bone. A new change to Homeward Bones as well, if you haven't noticed it, is that you can now not just return to the bonfire you were at, but you can also return directly to Firelink Shrine, which I think is a great addition to the series. I think I may have talked about this in the last episode, but if not, sometimes whenever the game is struggling to load or taking a while to load, this will pop up. You're not getting invaded, there's no boss fight at Firelink Shrine, it's just the game taking its sweet time. to load up. Now, before we go downstairs to check out what's different, let's talk about shields. You see here, each of these three shields has something different. This one here has a little round symbol, and its skill is to parry, so as always, skill is to parry, so that's L2 or LT on an Xbox controller, parry. If we change to one with this little blade symbol, you see here it's weapon skill, so equipping the shield in the left hand allows one to perform the skill of the right hand weapon. So if I equip this, and let's check this one. Yeah, this is a good one to check out. We have battle cry on this war axe, which will boost your damage and be generally very good. So if we want to use that, we have this shield in our left hand with the ability, and it lets us use the ability of our right hand weapon, like so. Another good reason to get a deep battle axe, not only do you get damage and stuff, but having a shield like this lets you power up even more using Warcry. As you can see here, the little blue bar underneath my HP, every single time I use, that'll go down. That's a weapon skill. That and magic. Weapon skills and magic will drain that FP bar, and it can be replenished by using an Ash Nestus flask, of which I've drained all the power from, or I think there's various upgrades and things that can also do the job. Finally, we have one I'm not even going to be able to show you, I don't think, because you need 36 strength to use it. But its ability is Shield Bash. Without lowering your guard, strike the enemy with the shield to knock them back or stagger them. Works well, equipped in either hand. Let's check out this Great Shield, actually. I've never even found it before, so this is brand new to me too. Great Shield of the renowned Lothric Knights, decorated with a holy symbol. The knights who formed the High Priestess's guard carried great shields such as these, which were granted high magic absorption through her blessing. So they have high magic absorption, which is great, 83% and 100% physical, as you'd imagine. Another reason to start as the knight, by the way, is the knight shield starts with 100% physical as well. But here, so does the Silver Eagle Kite Shield. I never realised that. I'm probably going to equip that for the time being. Of course, the Night Shield has better absorption on a lot of other stuff, but the ability to use Warcry and stuff's pretty good, and I've not really been using parries as much, so I think that's fine. I didn't even show you Shield Bash. I don't know if we can show you Shield Bash, but I'm going to give it a go anyway. Okay, so there you go, that's what Shield Bash looks like. We're going to switch up to this. Each weapon, of course, has its own different sort of weapon skill. We're not really going to make any use of them in this playthrough, so if you're used to playing the old style Souls without any weapon skills, this is probably a good one to watch, because I'm not going to rely on them at all or use any of them, because I'm not really used to that kind of thing. Heading downstairs for our last thing of the day before we wrap this up. Grey Rat's moved in. He'll ask you if you've put the ring down, I think.
Oh, hello, you're back. And in one piece. Well, now it's time I do my part. Whatever trinket you need, speak up. Just don't ask me where I got them.
So, funny little guy, Grey Rat, and a couple of things to note. First of all, he's a merchant, which is great. He sells some nice stuff, and his stock will change depending on sort of actions you take throughout the game. But I don't think this is the episode to talk about that. I think we should wait. The second thing to note is that every NPC in the game who's a merchant, you can sell stuff to, so that's great as well. It's a nice little addition. So let's see what he has right now. Embers, we're not really needing. Just bleeding build up, I don't really think we need anything to do with that either right now. Throwing knives, firebombs. Firebombs can be quite useful for the area we're in. The mace, if you want to go blunt, or a spear. He has the bastard sword, which is always a great option, as we know in these games. Longsword, which I started with. The bandit's knife. Bleed is very good in this game. I've not really made great use of it, but watching other people run through and use bleed is pretty scary to see the amount of damage that it does. It's pretty cool. You get the buckler, which is great for your parries, your crossbow. Let's see what this says. So this is very similar, I think, to either Creighton or Benhart stuff. I know Benhart was from Yugo, but he did steal his armor from someone else who I think was from Mira. And he had that shield, I'm sure. The standard round shield, the kite shield, which from the looks of it looks like it's taken its design from the Drang Lake shield from Dark Souls 2. Then we have the standard armor, which of course is basically what Pate wore in Dark Souls 2 as well. Very nice. And the thief mask, which is always awesome, so I think I'm actually going to buy that, just for the fashion purposes. And then there are arrows, so if you want to go back and take out that dragon, there you are.
Goodbye. Oh, this place is a bore. What good is thievery if you've nowhere to go?
So that's kind of foreshadowing. Grey Rat has a questline of his own, quite a lot of them do. Now, I think you know it now, of course, is NPCs and the way these candles work. Basically, anywhere you see candles around here, barring the staircases, of course, I think is roughly where an NPC can pop up. I do know some locations are NPCs. There's one there. One pops down over here. I'm sure one is over there as well. And down each of these little hallways at either end, there'll also be some NPCs. So that's how it works in terms of NPCs in this game. But we've covered quite a lot today. And we've pretty much finished the first area. We only have two more tasks to complete. A sort of sideways task, which is necessary, and then the boss itself, and then we're on to the next area of the game. I'm glad to be back and doing this, guys. I hope you guys are enjoying this series. I know I'm a little bit behind everyone else, but we're going to catch up super quick if we can. And if you enjoy this series, I hope you stick around for some more episodes. But until then, guys, don't have a pretty awesome thing for you. Let's see, do we have anything we can switch to? We have the rest of the collapse. I like the rest. Till next time, guys. Stay kindled.